Today's video is brought to you by PaperLike, which makes writing or drawing on your iPad Pro feel more like paper. Hey, it's Chris. Now, I've been using the iPad Pro as my primary computer, like my main go-to device, for the last week or so. And it's been fun, and it's been interesting. It's been a little bit frustrating, but at the end of the day, there's something that's really satisfying about getting everything done on this one beautiful slab of glass. And during this last week, I've really realized something, and it's this, that the iPad Pro in particular is never gonna be a shot-for-shot remake of the Mac, meaning it's never gonna be an actual Mac replacement. This is a very, very important point here. What it can be, though, instead, is an alternative. Not a replacement, but yes, it is an alternative. And I already felt like this before. You guys saw my last video about this subject, the iPad bias. I'll link it up down below if you want to catch up. But it can be a good alternative. In fact, it can be a great alternative. Just to give you an idea of what is coming up in this video, I'm going to be talking about the apps and the tips and the techniques that I've been using to make the iPad Pro more usable, coming from somebody who is just using or used to the Mac. And at the very end of this video, we're gonna do something new. It's something that we've been doing, but we're giving it a name. It's gonna be called the After Party, and that is when we are gonna interact, when I'm gonna answer some of your questions. We even have a theme song.
And we talking to the fans, it's the time, yeah. Welcome to the other party, got it vibe.
Okay, so this is the part of the video that most of you are gonna be the most excited about. And these are the actual nitty gritty, real techniques and apps and ways that I have made using the iPad Pro, my primary computer, more streamlined. Now I'm gonna hit all kinds of things in this section, but I wanna start with some key hardware accessories, a few things that have just made my experience much better. The very first one is HyperDrive, which is an iPad Pro specific USB-C dock. Now I mentioned this several videos back in my unbelievably useful iPad Pro accessories video, but I didn't actually have it in hand then. I do now. The latest iPad Pros introduced a USB-C port, which opened all kinds of doors, but it was still only that one port. What the HyperDrive does is give you several additional ports that can make your life that much easier. It gives you an HDMI port, which is very important for people who do things like presentations. It gives you a USB-A port, the older USB port, which is important because not all your accessories, probably, are USB-C still. It gives you a headphone jack, which if you're somebody like a musician, for instance, you might be really excited about. You also get an SD card slot, which is great if you mess around with photos or videos, because now you don't have to have a bunch of different dongles. One adapter for everything. Even though the HyperDrive itself plugs into your USB-C port, I like that it has a USB-C port with power pass-through, so you don't really lose out on anything. I love that it has a guide so it fits your iPad Pro perfectly, and I also love that it matches my iPad Pro's color. Another accessory that's made iPad Pro life more bearable is a wireless external hard drive. Of course, right now, at the time of recording, you still can't use an external wired hard drive. So this is sort of a workaround. I've been using the Western Digital My Passport Wireless Pro, and it works pretty well for just about everything except for video editing, which is what I happen to do. If you're working with photos, great. If you're working with music, great. If you're just working with wanting extra space to save your regular file types, like your documents and backups and whatever, it's pretty great. But for video editing with LumaFusion in particular, which it's meant to work with, it just hasn't been my favorite. And I don't want to bog this video down with all the details. If you're interested in a separate video or something about that, then let me know. Picking the right keyboard for yourself as an iPad Pro user can go a long way towards making it more useful to you personally. Now, there's a lot of great options, and I've reviewed a couple. I'll leave links down below if you want to check those out. The Apple keyboard is so portable, but it's missing a few things. But the funny thing is, I keep coming back to it after a while because it's so portable. There's something that Apple did there that's right. I do miss the function keys when I'm using the Apple keyboard, but picking the right keyboard for yourself is very important if you're going to use this day in and day out as your one and only machine. The last hardware accessory is just a really good power supply. I use the iPad Pro so much that I can wear that battery down pretty quickly. If I'm not working, maybe I'm gaming, right? I'm using it for everything. So the thing I've been using to power it up when I'm away from my desk or when I'm on the go is a Zero Lemon massive beast of an external portable battery. And I'm gonna link that up down below. It's so powerful, it could actually power your MacBook Pro. All right, next up, I wanna talk about some key utilities, some apps that you need to use if you want to have a more robust experience with your iPad Pro. The first one that I wanna talk about is just a must install. It's called Yoink, which is kind of a funny name, but if you're not doing drag and drop on the iPad Pro, you're really doing it wrong. If you're not using multiple windows and the multitasking interface and dragging something from here to there and all over the place, you need to hone those skills. You need to figure out how to do that because it's key to enjoying the iPad Pro. And Yoink goes a long way towards making that experience even better. What Yoink is basically a digital shelf. So you can bring it up on your screen, you can drag and drop stuff into it, and then within Yoink, you can organize all that stuff into collections. It's just sort of a holding place where you can organize some stuff and then take it from there and drop it into whatever other apps you may want to use those items in. It's brilliant, it's a time saver, it can really, really increase your productivity and make you feel more like a power user. File browser is the best way that I have found up to this point to view and organize your files, basically just to work with files. I think it's much better than the built-in file browser that comes with your iPad for the moment. Why is it so good? It's just because it's so comprehensive. You can see everything in there and you can do a little bit more than you could otherwise. So you can see your wireless drives, for instance. You can see your iCloud drive. You can see your other cloud storage, everything all in one place with more options of what you can do with those files. The next key utility that you have to check out is called Opener. Something that drives me nuts on the iPad and sometimes just in iOS in general is that I have an app installed that can do a certain thing and I click a link or I tap a link and it opens in Safari. It opens in the browser. That drives me absolutely up the wall. Why doesn't it open in that specific app that's made for that thing? That happens with YouTube a lot, for instance. Opener fixes that, and it will let you actually pick what you want different links and stuff to do, what you want them to open in. This is something that once you've used it, you're gonna be like, how was I living on the iPad Pro without this in the first place? One question that I get all the time is how do I deal with zipped files or zipping files on the iPad Pro? That's been a major pain point for a lot of people, and there's actually a lot of different apps that try to address this that will let you zip or unzip something. The best one that I have found so far is actually just called Zipped. Not a lot to say about it. It just lets you zip and unzip stuff, and it's my favorite. And by the way, I'm gonna link all these up down below. Another really big deal or issue for people has been that they can't open certain websites, the full version of websites, on mobile Safari because it just doesn't work. It loads the mobile version or it says, there's no way I'm loading this. One workaround that works pretty well at this point is Puffin Browser. Basically, it defaults to opening the full desktop version of websites. It doesn't even mess around with the mobile versions. And it really works pretty decently. I think everybody out there kind of has this one web app that they rely on and that they use, whether you're at work or at school, that you just need to work. And it's not working on the iPad Pro. There's a good chance that this could fix it. And for me, I'd say it's fixed about 80% of those problems. Not 100%, it's not perfect, but wow, it really makes things better. Now, this is something I feel like I've talked about a lot before, but it's just something that you have to know if you're gonna use the iPad Pro or just the iPad in general, keyboard shortcuts. You have to start using keyboard shortcuts. It changes completely everything that you do. If you're using the iPad and you reach for your mouse and it's not there, but there's an action that you want to take, but you're not sure how, hold down the command key. In whatever app that you have open, it's gonna pull up a list of the available keyboard shortcuts. You don't have to memorize them. You can always just pull up this list and check out what's available. People ask me in the comments all the time, what about not having a mouse on the iPad Pro? And you know what? I really don't miss it all that much. Knowing these keyboard shortcuts makes your life like 95% easier and better and more fluid on the iPad Pro. And if you're really putting them to good use, I really don't think you're gonna miss the mouse all that much for most applications. Most. Something else that's made a huge positive impact on my iPad Pro workflow is better utilization of widgets. My main productivity stack right now, which consists of Trello and MindNode and Drafts, all live on that widget screen. And when it's time to do something in any of those apps, I know I can just swipe over, tap once, and get right into whatever it is I need to get into. For a lot of the past several years on all my iOS devices, I've basically just ignored that widget screen. And I understand this is something that probably might be changing with WWDC coming up too, but right now, I'm getting a lot of use out of it. It makes a big difference. Siri shortcuts is another thing that can make a big impact on the way that you work. For me, I have all these repetitive tasks that I need to do and actions that I need to access within apps. And if I do it the old way, which is just open the app, I kind of have to go through all these different layers to get to what I'm after. One example from my life is just needing to be aware of everything new in the tech and more specifically, Apple realm. And so if I go into the news app and I have to go open up the sidebar, click on Apple or click on my saved stories to kind of get into research mode and see what I had that I was interested in there. Well, with shortcuts, I can save a lot of time and just go right to my favorite sources or to my saved stories with one tap right off the widget screen. One other thing that I'll mention, and it's just a crutch, I really shouldn't even put it in here because it kind of defeats the whole purpose of this video, but you can use a virtual connection to a Mac that you have if there's really something that you can't be separated from. Like if you need to use Final Cut Pro, you can actually use it on your tablet, on your iPad Pro, through a virtual interface. I mean, it's possible, but that's all I'm gonna say about it because that's not the point of this video. Now, I'm not really gonna talk about all the actual apps that I use on my iPad Pro in this video because that's something I've covered extensively in the past. In fact, I'll link up the video that I made on the best iPad Pro apps, the apps that make using the iPad Pro actually worth it, in my opinion. I'll link that video up down below. But what I do wanna transition into now is talking about kind of the mentality of using the iPad Pro and my experience over the last several days and week of just trying to use the iPad Pro exclusively. The main distinction that I really wanna point out here is not whether you can use the iPad Pro instead of a Mac. Of course you can. It's a different experience, but of course you can. The thing I wanna point out is that I want to use the iPad Pro over the Mac. If I can get away with it, I want to. And that says something. So why do I want to use the iPad Pro if I can over the Mac? Well, I find it actually is kinda hard to put into words, but I think it has something to do with the iPad Pro's minimalism or just the fact that I can do more with less. Like my iPad Pro weighs less than my MacBook Pro, and that matters if I'm stuffing my backpack full of stuff and I'm off to an event. I want to shave off as much weight as I possibly can. And my iPad Pro packs up a lot faster than my MacBook Pro. I don't have to sit there and eject drives and all this stuff. It's just unplug one thing and I'm out of here. I also have less clutter on my desk when I just am using an iPad Pro. There is no mouse and there's no mouse pad. And it just feels a little bit less cluttered. I also like how apps on the iPad Pro all show up on one plane right now. So one window can't be covering another one and nothing's getting buried. So in my brain, it feels like there's less digital clutter and I can concentrate on whatever is on the screen right there. I like the minimalism aspect, even though I wouldn't consider myself a minimalist. And to tell you the truth, there are several apps that I prefer to use on the iPad Pro or iPad than the Mac. Like MindNode, for instance. It's one of the main apps that I use. For some reason, I just like to organize things visually with these mind maps, and MindNode is so great with the touch experience. And again, you have to know all the different shortcuts and stuff, but the resources are there. You can learn it. You gotta do things a little bit differently, but it's worth it, for me anyways. So if you're looking for a new iPad, then check out today's sponsor, PaperLike, which is an accessory that makes it feel and sound like you're writing on real paper when you're using an Apple Pencil. PaperLike actually gives you more control when you're writing or drawing thanks to the paper-like resistance that it offers, and yeah, it really makes a big difference. Plus, it reduces glare, and thank goodness, fingerprints as well. PaperLike works with all iPad models. PaperLike is great for anyone who uses apps like Notability or Procreate, and when you place an order, you'll get two PaperLike covers plus application vacation accessories with free worldwide shipping and a 100% satisfaction guarantee. And you can pick one up using the link down in the description. All right, let me officially welcome you to the after party.
Welcome to the other party, got it vibe. Well, you know we getting lit and come alive. And you know we got a light, so we gon' shine. And we talking to the fans, it's the time, yeah.
What did you think about that new intro song by Trey Little? If you haven't gone already to the link I mentioned down below to hear the whole song, then make sure to go click it whenever you're done here. Check out Trey's channel. I mean, he's doing some awesome stuff over there. Thank you, man, for making such an amazing song. Shalon Sharma says, do you get fatigue from using the touchscreen all the time? The keyboard and trackpad are designed to require minimal effort, so surely an iPad is less convenient. I see what you're saying. It absolutely seems like up in your head that it's more work to have your finger going all the time, like on the touchscreen. It doesn't feel like more work for me. It does on touchscreen desktops. That is much more inconvenient. Would not want to do that instead of using a mouse. Almost never use the touchscreen on the desktop that I have that has a touchscreen. But on the iPad, there's something about it. It's not bad. That's just my personal take though. Philip brings up the issue of browser plugins. More specifically, that you can't get them. Like if you rely on a certain Chrome plugin on your desktop, you don't have that here. And that is one thing that's a gaping hole for iPad Pro users. Now, for me, there's like four or five Chrome plugins that I use all the time on my Mac, and I don't have those here, and it's just kind of an inconvenience. In my workflow, I can get around those by doing things a different way, but it definitely takes longer. So that's one thing that, yes, is a pain. There's several people asking if this is something they should use as a college student. And I think my answer to that is, if I was back in college right now, I would rather have the iPad Pro than the MacBook Pro, probably. Unless you had some specific thing, like you were in design and whatever, you needed certain design programs that were only on the Mac. But for like general student use, I would way rather have the iPad Pro. It's just lighter, it's easier to carry around, and it's plenty powerful. All right, somebody asked, are there any moments when you're using the iPad Pro when you wish you were doing whatever you're doing on the MacBook? Honestly, yeah, there are. In my workflow, when I go to upload a YouTube video and everything that's associated with that, it still is easier for me on the MacBook Pro because I'm used to that interface. And the same thing with like Photoshop. There are great photo editors on the iPad Pro, and you know what? They work really well. I just have to take the time to invest to get to know them, and they're just different than what I'm used to. I would rather open up Photoshop on the Mac and get to work there. It's faster because it's what I'm used to. So I need to start getting more used to these iPad Pro apps. And when Photoshop comes to the iPad, I feel like I'll be right at home. And then at that point, I would rather do it on the iPad Pro. So I think things are shifting to the point where I won't have as many moments where I wish I was on the Mac, but I do still have some. Okay, somebody asked if my eyes ever get tired using the iPad versus a PC or Mac monitor. To be very honest, that's not even something I've ever even thought about. So I guess it hasn't been a problem for me in the slightest. All right, Jan says, I could just about do this, switch to the iPad only, but I need a Mac to run InDesign. I have so many legacy files, and she says she's moving on from being a professional designer. She's close, yada, yada, yada. Here's what I have kind of done in some instances, is just say, I know I'm starting over, and I know I'm gonna have to invest a little more time to figure out a few new ways to do things. And for me, it's worth it to do that because I like the lightness and the minimalism of just using just this one small device for all the stuff that I do. It's worth it for me. So if it's worth it for you, you might say, yeah, it's time to blow it all up and start over. And I think that's the only real answer there. The legacy files maybe someday are gonna work from like InDesign, but maybe it's just time to start over. Either that or it's not worth it, right? All right, Eunice says, does the iPad Pro have the same processing power of the MacBook Air? I'm shopping for a new computer and I'm wondering if the iPad Pro is just as powerful. Yeah, the iPad Pro is a beast. In fact, it's as powerful or more powerful than some MacBook Pros. Okay, here's a question that says, do you think the MacBook Air's butterfly keyboard problem should be a reason not to buy it right now? Now, it's not specifically an iPad related question, but it's related because maybe you're shopping and you're comparing those two different devices. And this is a tough one. For me personally, I know a lot of people have been complaining, and if your keyboard were to break, then that feels like the end of the world. I've had a few keyboard issues since my 2016 MacBook Pro was bought, but they were all resolved. There's nothing that I had to like go into the Apple Store. My wife's computer, we did have to take in. And so there is a real issue there, right? But I feel like it can get taken care of if you need to get it taken care of. For me, I enjoy the Mac experience enough that it wouldn't stop me from getting it over a PC. But if you're comparing like iPads to Macs, I don't know. I don't think the keyboard should have really anything to do with it. If it was me, I would look at the workflows more than anything. Royston says, thoughts on the Bridge keyboard versus Apple's own keyboard, portability versus usability. Yeah, let me weigh in on this a little bit more. I've reached out to Bridge like a million times asking for a review unit. I've never even heard anything back from them. I don't know if they don't want me to review it. I might just have to buy it, bite the bullet and get it for you guys. Let me know if that's something you want to see. Although a million people have already been asking for it. Bridge, what's wrong with you? You gotta send this over. Like, the people want to see the Bridge keyboard on this channel. But yeah, that is the thing, usability versus portability. I mentioned this earlier, I keep coming back to the official Apple keyboard because it's so simple, because there's something about it. Like, on the one hand, it frustrates you because it doesn't have certain functions. I wish it had a light to let me know when the caps lock was on. I'm always typing in all caps, drives me nuts. I wish there was function keys. But the other keyboards that I've used with it, they have enough drawbacks that I keep migrating back to what Apple has. So really, if you had to make a decision, it's probably gonna depend on the kind of work that you do. If you want something that you can easily remove and add back on because you're gonna be doing a lot of handwriting, then I think Apple's keyboard just nails it. It nails it for that kind of stuff. But if you know you're gonna be typing more and using the Apple Pencil a lot less, then I'm assuming the Bridge keyboard is awesome because everyone says it is. Wish I could check it out. But you know, the ones that I've checked out, the Logitech and the Zag, they're really suited for that more typing, writing, office-y experience. Patrick has a really good question. What's it like actually using the iPad, say for a term paper, where I would have to look at a bunch of different web pages and constantly research different things and cite all of them? Now, I don't have a direct answer for this, but I do want to point out an app that I know works really great for research. It's called Phrase. It just came out publicly. It's spelled F-R-A-S-E. It's all about research. And I expected this not to work well in the Safari browser on my iPad Pro, but it works great. It seems to be the full-featured experience. So I'd say it depends on what you do and what your workflow is, but some powerful apps and services can run and work for you. So I would check out something like Phrase, and I'll link it up down below. Is it possible to be a YouTuber or filmmaker on the iPad Pro? Editing, uploading, channel management, etc. Oh, it's definitely possible. You are going to have to change your expectations and learn a few different ways to do things. I can't think of like all the examples. It's possible, but it might be a little bit painful making that transition and kind of waiting for certain things that you're used to catch up and come to the iPad Pro. Very possible though. Shirag says, is the iPad Pro just by itself a good device, also future-proof for a medical student for taking notes, presentations, lectures, Netflix? Okay, let me address the future-proofing aspect of this, because you can never really future-proof. Like, someday you're gonna have to update and upgrade your device. But I think the iPad Pro is excellent in future-proofing, at least for the next several years. Maybe more years than what you'd get with the MacBook Pro. It's so fast, the iPad Pro. It's so capable. It's going to be running smoothly for years to come. I mean, 5 years, at least, probably, with all the updates that Apple's known to do. I would feel very comfortable getting an iPad Pro as a student and knowing that this is gonna be a workhorse for me. It's so fast. Yosef says, I'm considering making the move. He's got a 2017 MacBook Pro, and he wonders what the drawbacks would be making the switch. The main drawback, I think, for anybody considering making the switch from a Mac to an iPad Pro or otherwise, is going to be the amount of time that you'll need to invest, which is gonna be some to a significant portion, to relearn or discover new ways to do things. That's the drawback. Storm says, since there's no mouse support, how is it to edit video? Is it a pain in the butt? I thought it would be a pain, but I actually like using the Apple Pencil with LumaFusion, for instance. There's something fun about it. I mean, I can go lay on the couch or something and just get the pencil and, you know, you can do things that you can't do with a mouse, for instance. I like it. I'm not gonna say that I like it better, but I like it in its own way. Joe says, do you think that desktop software like Premiere Pro, After Effects, etc. will come to the iPad like Photoshop is doing? Yeah, I think so. I don't know how long it's gonna take, but I do think those more powerful apps are absolutely coming. I could be wrong, because I don't work at Apple or anything. I don't have some insider info, but I feel like yes. Can the iPad Pro 2018 edit 4K Smart HDR or HDR 10 video, which is recorded at 60 frames per second? I would have thought that the iPad Pro could edit any kind of file type in LumaFusion, which is the leading video editor on the iPad platform. But I was surprised when I tried it out. Things like 60 frames per second video shot on the Osmo Pocket, for instance, wouldn't load up properly. There were issues. That was like one of my big sticking points when I was trying to use LumaFusion. So you need to research what camera you have and what kind of files you're gonna be shooting and check, is that going to work with LumaFusion or whatever you're gonna be using on the iPad Pro? So the answer is maybe. Felix wants to know about workflows and productivity when losing Alfred on the Mac and just file management. How do you optimize using the cloud? Rather than try to get into any specifics, today, the day that I'm shooting this, Federico Vitici over at Mac Stories just released a massive article, 50,000 plus words, on his iPad-only workflow. And if you want really to dive deeply into this subject matter and workflows and how to get advanced and make everything work really well, you have to go check out that article. In fact, I'll link it up down below. Rob says, does the iPad have enough RAM to handle all the tasks that I perform on my Mac? I have yet to run into anything, although I've seen other people claim that they have, that has made my iPad Pro freak out or slow down. It's such a beast that whatever you can do with the available apps is probably, I would say almost certainly, it's gonna be able to handle. Are there any good photo editing apps that could replace Lightroom? If you're looking for Lightroom alternatives, there's some great stuff. Pixelmator Photo just came out and it's really powerful, really been enjoying that. And also, Darkroom has been great. I've really enjoyed that, especially for editing like raw photos. So yeah, there are some other really good options out there. They're different, so it may take a little bit of time to learn it and get used to it. That's kind of the recurring theme I feel like I keep saying in this video. But yeah, Avenger Sid is wondering about gaming in the future on the iPad Pro. I'm gonna make a whole video on iPad Pro or just iPad gaming. I'm super excited about gaming on the Pro. I've really been getting into it. We already have Fortnite. You can already use a controller. Steam Link is, I think, already here. It's landed. We have Apple Arcade coming. I'm already gonna make a video about this. So stay tuned, hit subscribe, turn on your bell notifications if you wanna see that. I'm very excited about gaming on the iPad Pro or just the iPad, iPad gaming. It's awesome. All right, that is it for this video, and that's it for the after party. Let me know what you guys thought of the theme song. Again, please go check out my man Trey Little, who was kind enough to write this dope song for us. I'll link it up again down below, along with his channel. Go check it out. He has a lot of interesting stuff to say. All right, go support him. Let me know what other questions you have about iPad Pro and Mac-related stuff down in the comments. I'll do my best to answer those, and probably some other people in the community will as well. Don't forget you can follow at DailyTekk, spelled Daily T-E-K-K, on Instagram and Twitter, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Later.